I was watching a video last night, and it was about some of the history of mathematics and to a certain extent physics. I can't remember the name of it, but and I only watched half of it, but it was about developments in late 19th century and early 20th century mathematics predominantly, with a bit of physics, and the effects of this mathematics on well, on the zeitgeist generally, but particularly on the psychology of these mathematicians and physicists who'd been involved in this. And the half I saw of it was Georg Cantor and Boltzmann. Oh, God, and the dog when I was turning around. Baby guy, come on! And the idea was that that Cantor, in his work on infinitesimals and the concept of the infinite, the narrator of this documentary kept coming back to the idea that Cantor had kind of seen something which had driven him mad. And Cantor apparently did end his life in an insane asylum. And the assumption throughout this was that, you know, there's something about this mathematics which drives people mad. And the same thing was applied to Boltzmann, a physicist, but again the implication was that the mathematical underpinnings of his physics had somehow driven him mad, and Boltzmann ended his own life by suicide, hung himself, which it might have been due to all kinds of things. He had a bit of a troubled life, but the implication was that, again, he'd seen something which had driven him mad. Now, I know it's, in a sense it's playing on a kind of myth, but at the same time, I think it's quite interesting, this idea that there is a mathematics which can drive people mad. It kind of offers a way of looking at the world, or a particular sight, and as I say, the documentary kept using sight metaphors. It can offer a sight to the mind's eye, which is so troubling and so disturbing that that your sanity is lost as a result. I don't know who the other two mathematicians were. My guesses would be somebody like Kurt Gödel, Alan Turing, something like that, I'm guessing. I don't know who it goes into. But a kind of relationship between mathematics and madness. You also find it in fiction as well, actually. There's a great story by, what's it called, Norman Kagan, he's called. It's called The Mathenauts. I think it was written in the 60s. But that story is about, it's a science fiction story, about an imaginary laboratory in which they make a vessel. It's a bit like a spaceship. But instead of this spaceship flying through real space, it kind of instantiates mathematical spaces and then occupies those spaces. So you can get in this space and you can enter kind of Zermelo-Frankel set theory space, or you can enter Minkowski space, or you can kind of literally inhabit, the space will literally inhabit non-Euclidean spaces, for example. Again, fascinating idea. And in that short story, again, there's the idea of madness. That if you were to experience those spaces without certain protective features of this spaceship, you would go mad, and one of the characters in fact does. Interestingly enough, I think in that, one of the protective features in this ship that stops people going mad, that maintains part of the ship within regular Newtonian space and stops the whole thing entering into non-Euclidean space, is that it carries a kind of psychological ballast. It carries a number of people on board who are very kind of down-to-earth people, very straightforward thinking, who don't have any relationship to mathematics and physics. They might be undergraduate students who are studying business, for example, or something like that, who don't have any truck with those kinds of more esoteric thoughts. And the presence in this ship, in this story at least, of these more straightforward thinking psychologies preserves the psychic integrity of part of the ship and locates it in Newtonian space. And the other fiction, I think, that has that sense of the mass that drives you mad is an old story called Flatland by Edwin Abbott, in which two-dimensional life form, a square, somehow gets in communication with a human being, a person, and introduces that person to what life is like in flatland where the square lives. And it's a description of, which plays out the implication of what life would be like if it was played out on a two-dimensional surface rather than the three-dimensional volume that we appear to live in. Where madness enters that story is, towards the end of that story, the human being, the person who is has been introduced to the mysteries of flatland, speculates about, to what extent we as three-dimensional beings are artificially constrained by our three-dimensionality, and whether and what it would be like to imagine a kind of four-dimensional or five-dimensional way of being. Of course, he's assumed to be mad. Those are mad thoughts that could only be entertained by a mad brain. So again, you have this relationship between mathematics and madness. I think it's quite interesting, actually. I think it's not interesting on number for a number of reasons. Firstly, I think I find the association between mathematics and physics, which is largely a mathematical science anyway, mathematics and physics and madness to be an interesting one. Because you don't get an association with biology and madness, or carpentry and madness, or geography or geology, or what might broadly be called life sciences. Those aren't associated with madness. Maybe astronomy a little bit, but less so. You do get poets and artists associated with it, and there might be a relationship there. But it seems to be, at least in mythic terms, very much the remit of mathematicians and physicists to have access to madness through their work, or to glimpse things which drives you mad. So I'm just thinking what it could be, actually, that. And anyway, I'm just completely speculating, so it has no more authority than that, than the authority of a guest. But if I was to make a stab at it, I would think it must be something to do with the nature of our embodiment, the nature of our cognition, the nature of our grip on reality, if you like, whatever that means, which is located within that embodiment and that cognition. You know, here we are as evolved beings, evolved animals, on a planet. And at the scale that we operate, which, as Dawkins said, is medium size, where medium-sized objects moving at medium speed, he says, at the level of the embodiment that we have, the dominant physics and the mathematics which accompanies that physics is pretty much Newtonian. And there is some evidence, I know, that we do seem to have a kind of innate sense of Newtonian physics and the variant in that, which is sometimes called folk physics or naive physics. But it's broadly speaking Newtonian. We seem to understand that almost at the fabric of our cognition, by which I think I mean that part of the fabric of our cognition, part of the possibly innate, but certainly reinforced in an early age, part of the physics of our being itself and the mathematics of that is Newtonian, and presumably a lot of things hang off that. If that's part of our fundamental understanding, then lots of things will be attached to that, hung off and that, dependent upon that, be built in relationship to that, and not just literally, but also metaphorically. The world that we move through is like this. It's largely a three-dimensional world with objects and doing what objects do in this kind of space. And this is the space and the experiences that we have, the phenomenological experiences that we have, that we seem to draw upon for all of our metaphorical understandings of more abstract concepts like justice and truth and love and all those kind of things. So, you know, if all of that massive edifice of cognition is ultimately built upon some fairly blunt tools, largely obeying the cognitive equivalent of Newtonian physics, then I suppose if you start tinkering too much with those physics and those maths, and you start questioning the parameters of those things, to the point where you really understand them and are entertained by them, held mutually by those ideas, then maybe that's what you are doing. Maybe you are moving the foundations of the house that you live in. Maybe you are, just changing everything. It doesn't feel like you're changing everything. But maybe you are. Maybe on some non-conscious processing level, you're undermining the foundations of everything that you know, really. Not surprised people go mad under those circumstances. I must have a think at some point why artists and poets were also associated with this, actually, as well, at some point. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a kind of related thing going on there.